Hi, it's Larry here from Xbox Live's Major Nelson. Welcome to the show. Jeff and I are together in the studio for show number, it looks like around 600.
This is round up, show number 2000.
What are you? You can't just start making
the
numbers.
The numbers, they don't mean... Larry, you make up the numbers.
Show 4100, so...
Thank you. a celebration.
But you can argue with the numbers all you want, but what you can't argue with is the fact the show has been on the air for 15 years.
That's true.
Right?
I've been here for almost a third of
the longest running podcast here.
Featuring Larry Hryb.
No, I think at Microsoft ever.
I believe that.
Yeah, because I started doing it when everyone was...
Does Bill have one? Does he have a show?
I've had him on this show.
Really?
Yes, I had him on this show.
In this very chair?
Not in that chair. We interviewed it.
Just
was
tell
in
me
E3.
Yes.
Where was it? It was at E3. I want to say 2007 or 8. And I had him on. We interviewed him up in... what was that hotel? Was it the Roosevelt? I think it was the Roosevelt. You know, down in Hollywood?
Sure.
When we had our briefing across the street at the... The
Kodak Theater.
The Chinese Theater.
Man's.
Yeah, at Man's Chinese Theater.
Oh, wow.
So we did that.
Never been in there.
It's, I think.
So that hotel, I did stay in that hotel one time. I did an event there. And what's really interesting, it's right across the street from that theater. And they do a lot of movie premieres there.
Yeah.
And while we were getting set up for an event that we were doing in that hotel in the Roosevelt, there was a TV. And one of the channels was a feed of a camera pointed directly at where all the limos drop off. And it took us a little bit to figure out, like, why is this here? It's so that whoever's staying there before a premiere, typically one would expect the stars of the show or whatever, they can watch everyone come in and they can time out when they would do their entrance.
Well, isn't that how everyone does it?
Maybe that's how you do it. I just show up like I did today.
You weren't late. You were right on time.
Thank you.
The listeners don't know. They started the show right on time, according to them.
They hit. I thought you were going to put in 5 minutes of silence just to represent.
No, I like to. You know me. I like early is on time. On time is late.
I'm usually late.
We're in the studio, as you can tell. We're kind of back from you were away.
Took a few days
off.
Where'd
you go?
Went up to Fair Canada. To Whistler.
As opposed to unfair Canada.
Well, there are some parts are fairer than others.
Okay.
I'm sure most people would agree
that
Whistler is as fair as it gets.
Yep.
And just doing some snowboarding and the like. And then we were there for 4 days and we had an Airbnb. And so, of course, I brought my Xbox. So it was
what'd you play?
Shred all day and Apex and Anthem all night.
Yeah, well, I'm playing Apex. I have, you know, a few wins. You have one.
I have one win. I think I have... somewhere in the neighborhood of 15 second place finishes.
Good.
It hurts. It happens a lot. I feel like I finished
first
second
worst.
Place more than I finished
first
anything
worst.
Else. It is. I'm the first loser. And I got to get more wins. I feel like, from a strategic perspective, doing everything right. And then when it comes down to
the end,
it all
falls apart. Well, we played that one match where we thought we had the high ground all of a sudden.
We were so smart.
These guys like Spider-Man'd in on us. They just dropped in. We're like, what?
Yeah, that happened. And then it happened to me again the next day.
Yeah.
And it's just, you know, it's a heck of a game, that Apex.
It sure is.
And they've done a great job.
You're playing weapon. You're playing Anthem as well?
Yeah, I'm really enjoying Anthem. Yeah. I've been using EA Access.
Which is this Friday. If you're EA Access member, you get 10 hours early.
Exactly. So chances are by the time you're hearing this, it is already out. Most games on EA Access, you know, it comes out between 3 and 7 days before, you know, before street date. And you typically get about 10 hours of some variance there from title to title. I don't usually come anywhere near using up the full 10 hours.
Really?
Usually, you know, I'll dabble. I'll play FIFA a little early every year or whatever it might be. I'm using up. I think I've got about an hour to go. It's Thursday as we're recording this. I will use that last hour up tonight, and then I will wait for my retail version
quietly
to kick in.
When it unlocks later this
week. I'm having a really good time with it.
Yeah, I played it last night or a couple nights ago, and I can see myself. I just right now. I mean, we've always talking about this. It's like, oh, there's too many games. There's this. There's Apex. There's a new map for Overwatch. I mean, the list goes.
That's
on.
Right. We haven't the Paris map.
We've got Crackdown 3, which I finished last week. We've got which is in Game Pass.
Yes. This is a very busy time. Metro.
Yeah. Oh, Metro.
Out.
I totally forgot about Metro.
Jump Force is out. Far Cry New Dawn is out.
Stop it.
Have you played that yet?
Yeah, I played a little bit of it.
And then we have a lot of stuff coming up, you know, around the bend, getting ready for Division 2.
Division 2?
This is one of the busier springs in memory.
And we've all...
Oh, and Devil May Cry.
Devil May Cry
is only a couple of weeks
so
away.
So that's, we've got that. We've got a bunch of stuff coming out. And I can confirm today.
Go.
As of right now, we will be, Jeff and I will be attending PAX East.
PAX East.
So we'll...
I booked my flight last night.
I know you did. I saw that. I need to book mine. We've got right now the podcast right now currently is scheduled, as they say, for Friday.
In Boston? They say that in Boston?
Friday. It's a wicked awesome Friday.
There we go.
So we'll be on Friday. Usually we're on Saturday, but we're going to change things up. We wanted to kind of just blow things around a little bit.
All of PAX has moved up. PAX starts a day earlier this year. Instead of it being Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, it's Thursday, Friday, Sunday.
But before it used to be just like 3 days. Now it's a whole other day.
Soon it will always be PAX.
Right.
It's PAX Day.
PAX Day.
It's PAX Day. Happy PAX Day.
So we'll have more details as we get closer to that. We're going to have some special guests, and we'd love to see you there if you're there on that Friday.
Yes. It's a good change of pace. I think you should grow out your beard for that.
You know, you have been after me to grow out this beard. I grew it out when you were gone. Because last week we had, in the Seattle area, quite a bit of snow.
Yes.
More so snow than Seattle normally gets.
Well, it's funny. Yeah, which is none,
right.
Or a dusting. And we both grew up in the Northeast. Yeah. And you would always hope it will be enough snow to not go to school growing up. And in Philly, the further south you go, the lesser amount of snow it takes to do that.
Right.
You get an inch in Atlanta, the city shuts down. In Philly, it was about 4 inches.
In Connecticut, it was about 5 to 8.
That makes sense. Right. And then the city can't function.
Right.
So here, Seattle is definitely in that. If it's more than a half an inch, the city shuts down. And we got about a foot.
Yeah, to be fair, we did get about a foot. And you and I were I'll never forget that. I was driving home. Remember, I was driving home and I was at a stoplight. So I texted you. I'm like, you know, what's going on over there? And you said, oh, the snow just started. I'm like, oh, it's all dry here. By the time I got to the next stoplight, it was a whiteout. It was just completely blinding.
Yeah, we had given up and just knowing it was going to go bad. We went to lunch and we came out and it was like, it was winter wonderland.
Yeah.
So, look, the rest of the country gets it. We don't get that very often. It was really, it was nice until you lost power.
For three days.
Really? Was it that long?
Yeah.
That was 3 good days of Apex second place finishes that I got.
That was, and I sent you a picture. I didn't post this. I should post this. I didn't post the photo of my solar panel.
What? What happened?
I showed you the solar panel, right?
Oh, is that what it was?
Yeah. What do you mean that's what it was? So I have a solar panel that, where is that picture? I think it's back here somewhere. But I had because we were without power, I'm like, what am I going to do? So I had hooked up a solar panel to my Switch.
Oh, that, yes.
And
yes.
I was charging my Nintendo Switch with solar power because we had no power.
You're part of the Green New Deal, Larry.
Okay. Well, I've been driving electric for how many years?
If you tweet that out, I'm sure AOC will follow back.
I am. I think she follows me already.
Sorry. Of course she does.
I think she was talking about Apex a couple days ago or something.
She's
like
a gamer. She's, I think she plays World of Warcraft and maybe StarCraft as well.
That's hardcore.
We're getting into an era now where, of course, all the politicians play games because they're like us.
Right.
Well,
they are like
the good
us.
Ones are.
Okay, that's it. That's the line in the sand. We don't go any further with politics.
Now we stop. Hey, let's talk about Crackdown.
Can we? Yeah, it's out now. It's available on Game Pass. Check it out. It is a fun romp.
That's a good way of putting it.
Wasn't that your back of the box quote?
A fun
romp in the city. So, Jeff Rubenstein.
Yes. Did you ever get quoted on a video game box?
Yes. Yeah.
What was it?
I don't remember.
A fun romp?
I don't remember what it was.
Is it one of the games you were in? Like, Kinect Sports Rivals or something.
Well, I'm still angry they put me in that one.
In a wetsuit.
Yeah, in a wetsuit that was sponsored, and they never gave me any. I didn't get a dime off of that.
Not only that, but the AI always finished in the last.
And I was always last.
Last place, Larry. what game? Do you remember what game you were quoted for?
I don't remember what it was. A long time ago.
So I got quoted once for Dragon Age 2. Okay. From BioWare, and I just remember EA calling and saying, "Hey, can we use your quote for the?" And it was, I forget what I'd said. Probably something like an action-packed extravaganza or a nonstop thrill coaster ride.
Right.
I don't know. I don't know what I said, but
you pay for the whole seat, but you'll only need the edge.
Ooh, that's a good one.
That was one of Steptoe's old. He used to say that all the time. It was a great quote he used to use.
that was a good one. Well, yeah, I'll save that for next time. But so that was the one time. But I thought it was really funny.
All right.
Henny, Crackdown. Crackdown. Also, you only need the edge of your seat if you can even see.
Blast of a fun. It's just
I just had a ton of fun. It was one of these games where as many games as there are to play.
And there are a lot.
And they're mostly really good games, by the way. Yeah. I just couldn't put it down. I just kept wanting. It's a very easy game to just jump into, play for, even if you only play for like 20 minutes, clear out a couple of vehicle depots or a monorail station and collect like, you know, 20 orbs. Once you start like dancing along the rooftops and picking up an orb or two, you just see, oh, there's another one. Well, I can't stop until I pick that one up.
Right, right.
Well, now I see another one. I got, right. I want to play. And I don't know. It very much grabbed me and I really enjoyed it. And actually, I haven't beaten it. I'm up to the very final boss, but I want to complete everything else.
I see.
I literally am on like the elevator or the base station, yeah, because you can just sort of teleport in right below the final boss or the sort of what I imagine will be the final sort of
right,
the final countdown. Do-do-do-do. And yeah, and I went back. I'm maxing out my skills. Great job. Great job with that.
Fun. Check it out. Game Pass.
Game Pass. But Apex.
Yeah.
So we haven't gotten to play in the last few days. Have we?
No, we haven't. More. It's kind of, you know, I don't know about you, the listeners. I know you, Jeff, or whatever, the same thing. You get on, you get your group of three people, you mm-hmm, plus two others, and you start playing, and then like another friend jumps on and they can't play because you already got a full team. So they go off and play with their three, and then one of your guys drops out or girls drops yep, out, and then you want to, so it's just like you're always in this off cycle, right?
Yeah. But it always feels like there's always, it just seems like on my place, at least, there's always a few people playing, and yeah, either I get in, I always like, I'm like, please have two, just be a party of two, be a party of two.
Oh.
And then sometimes it's not, sometimes it is.
Right.
But yeah, very much, I just really love how they have the players, the different characters going. As much as I like Lifeline, that my only win though is with Gibraltar. Mm-hmm. I'm sorry, with Bangalore.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's just weird. I want that Lifeline win.
Oh, okay, that's
respectful. I do.
I understand that.
I wish there was a thing that said you unlock sort of trackables so people can see. You can share which information you want. You don't have to share what level you're in. You don't have right, to anything like that. You can be a complete unknown. But I want something that says how many second place finishes I got. I wonder if they're tracking that.
Oh, it's in a database. It's in a database row somewhere.
Yeah, probably about as many as I have kills.
Right.
And then Anthem. As discussed, the feeling of flying in that game. They really nailed that. And I've just had a lot of fun exploring. It's another one where I would say most of my friends list is either playing Anthem or playing Apex. And they do a good job of matchmaking. I would say both of them do a good job of matchmaking. So even if you're going solo, you can communicate pretty well with
right,
other players.
Right,
and there's right, enough sort of guidance to make everyone cooperate. But yeah, I don't know when I'm going to be able to catch up with everything else. I haven't even started Resident Evil 2 yet.
Oh, you haven't?
I haven't.
I thought you started that before you left.
No, I just, I want to be able to like have time to just spend all of the, I haven't finished Kingdom Hearts 3.
Now there's a Dead or Alive 6 demo now available.
There is.
Know? Yeah.
Yeah. There's a couple free things.
Do you got some news you want to go through? And then
sure.
I have a great interview. I've got lined up with a really special guest. It's I'm really excited.
Talk to me about this.
It's Kate Remington. She hosts a music podcast called Music Respawn. She's a classical music, she studied classical music, but she hosts a classical music show on WSHU in Connecticut.
Shoo.
Which is a
you're listening to the shoe.
Which is a national public radio station. And she focuses on video game music. And she's very interesting, so we'll have her come along later on in the show. I've got the interviews.
All right,
before we do that, let's bang out some of the news. Big news week.
Yes. Well, of course, we had some Xbox Game Pass announces.
Let's talk about that.
So, coming soon, Batman, Return to Arkham. This is something that we had talked about on the most recent Inside Xbox.
So I'm Batman.
You are Batman. You and Rikari both got into it.
Yeah,
we did. You both did the mask, the face mask. It was more of a face hugger situation when you placed here. Anyway, Return to Arkham has both Batman Arkham Asylum and the very, very excellent Batman Arkham City. That was a game, and I'm not spoiling anything by saying that, but like when the credits rolled, it was a perfect ending to a perfect game.
Yep.
I just thought that like, and the Arkham Knight, the third one, was a great game too, but like Arkham City just really... Man, they did just a wonderful job of, you explored every part of that city by the time it was over.
Yep.
It had so much depth. They had so many...
It's fun.
It was fun, but it was also just like really clever, really
right,
intelligent. Yep. And so I haven't played it since last gen, so looking forward to these, of course, are the definitive edition of each game. It has all the post-launch content, and of course, it is sort of up-resed and enhanced for Xbox One. A couple other games, Headlander. Alien Isolation.
Mm-hmm.
You played this one.
Yeah. Oh, I finished it.
You love the Alien games. You beat this. You beat Aliens Colonial Marines.
Yeah. Well, I love the Alien series. That was one of my first like adult movies I remember going to see as a kid.
That explains a lot, actually, about you. Oh, it's funny. Disney's Epic Movie 2, or I'm sorry, Epic Mickey 2. This just came up in conversation yesterday.
Right.
Where we were talking about, did you know, like, sort of a bit of unusual arcana? So, Epic Mickey 2, so it's a co-op adventure between Mickey Mouse and Oswald. And Oswald's not as well known, but Oswald was a Disney... Walt Disney designed Oswald.
Oswald back in the Rabbit.
Yeah, like back in the 30s or something.
He predates Mickey Mouse.
But I guess Disney had no longer had like control of the character Oswald, I believe.
We're in uncharted territory because we don't have all the facts.
All right. Well, then anyway, there is like a thing, and I'll link to it, where Oswald was traded for Al Michaels, the sports guy.
What? How could that be?
Do you not? All right. We can come back to this.
We'll put it in the notes.
But it was there's actually a thing where like the rights to him. This was like a story. ESPN. Here's the headline: ESPN trades Al Michaels for Oswald the Lucky Rabbit. Like that was a thing that happened. And
ESPN is owned by Disney.
Yes,
that's
exactly.
Called corporate synergy.
Yes, exactly. And of course, the story that I'm looking at was on ESPN, but it's a really interesting story. It goes back to like 2005.
Right.
And I guess in a world where ESPN and Disney are the same company and there's video games. And anyway, that's why Al Michaels is the Sunday night, the NBC sports guy now and not, you know, Monday Night Football.
Right.
Yeah. I thought it was interesting. Apparently. You don't like football, Larry.
That's not true. That's not true at all.
It's fine.
I'm just
congratulations.
I'm struggling to see where you're going here. So,
well, that's that game, Epic Mickey.
Yes.
Epic
Mickey. That's where
it was. Is part of Xbox Game Pass.
Okay.
Joining February 21st, which by the time
people,
you hear this,
it took so long to get to that.
Look, Larry, if you want someone that's going to get straight to the point, this is going to be a 2-minute podcast.
That's not your job.
Next week, The Walking Dead season 2.
Yeah.
Is coming to Xbox Game Pass along with Alien Isolation. And of course, there is a deal. There's always a deal running. So if you don't have Xbox Game Pass, shame on you.
Yeah.
I'm just going to call it like I see it. But you have no excuse because you can join today, get your first 2 months for... How much would you pay for 2 months?
How much would I pay for 2 months with access to over 100 games?
Over 100 games,
Jeff,
including Crackdown.
I don't know. I don't know what that'd be. Would that be $10 a month? $20? I don't know.
One would say that those would still be good deals. However, you can get your first 2 months for just $2. Is that a sawbuck? $2?
I don't know.
I'll have to look that up. Anyway, what can you buy for $2 these days? You can maybe get a topping on a pizza without the actual pizza. You could just eat like a couple slices of pepperoni. Instead, you can get 2 months of Game Pass. Anyway, I think you should do it. That's just me.
What are you waiting for?
I've already done it. You know that.
I know that.
All right. A few other games coming out.
Yes.
So I don't know if you were playing Jump Force. That was a game that people were very excited about that has just come out in the last week on Xbox One. But if you are looking for more anime, well, One Piece World Seeker coming out on Xbox One on March 15th.
Mm-hmm.
So there's never been a better time to like these characters.
Yes.
Some free play days. So Halo Wars Definitive Edition and Halo Wars 2. Are this weekend going to be free between February 21st, again, by the time you're hearing this, and February 24th, my mom's birthday.
Is it?
It is.
Oh,
I should really buy her something. I think she wants an air fryer.
Yes.
Do you know what an air fryer is?
Yeah, we have one.
Oh, how does it work? Because how do you fry something with air?
You just put stuff in there and it fries it with air.
Nope. This doesn't make any sense.
That's it.
How is it? Anyway, mom, you're getting an air fryer and you can play... I hope she doesn't listen. Halo Wars 2 and Halo Wars Definitive Edition for free over the course of that weekend.
Are you really going to get her an air fryer? What is she going to? I mean, I know you love one.
I don't have one. I have an Instant Pot.
Not the same thing.
Well, again, frying. The whole point of frying. If someone says something is fried, you're dumping it in oil. So
right.
If it's an air fryer,
right.
How does that make any? How does that work?
Imagine.
That's like saying like an underwater airplane.
What?
No.
It's called a submarine.
Yes. It has a different word and it's a different thing and it's not an airplane. So
air fryer.
I have a lot to look into. I've bought my mom something and I don't even know what it is.
Okay.
And well, I'll hear about it one way or the other. That's for sure. when she says, I'm trying not to eat fried food, and I have to explain to her that I don't know how it works, but apparently air is involved. So and Treasure Stack. Treasure Stack. This is coming out coming up on Xbox One on March 1st. And this one is going to be cross-playable. Mm-hmm. That's something people like to talk about.
Yep.
So it is sort of like a puzzle game. It has sort of a treasure version of a Tetris-like dropping game. By the way, Tetris 99.
I know. You were talking about that. I saw
that. You played that at all?
I have not.
Very interesting. I think there's a lot to learn in that. I've been playing it like just a regular old Tetris game.
I don't know if I want a Tetris Battle Royale.
I think it's very clever. It did get me to sign up for Nintendo's online network. So mission accomplished, you guys.
Right.
I'm pretty good at Tetris. I have not yet finished in, I think the highest I finish is 8th or 9th place.
Right.
So, but there's a method to that madness. Playing Tetris with 99 other people at the same time, it's a little bit complicated.
Yep.
You mentioned the Dead or Alive 6 demo. That's now available for Xbox One. The Incredible Adventures of Van Helsing. There's a complete trilogy out. The Neo Geo King of Fighters 2003. Where were you in 2003?
Working at Xbox. Okay.
Where was I?
Oh, I don't know. You were,
I think I was a sports producer.
You were probably doing the weather on this.
I know, in the video that no one's going to find.
That is lost forever.
No one's
the internet can do so many things, and it is foiled by your video.
I know, and don't think I don't love it. Well, anyway, Neo Geo, King of Fighters, you might have been playing it at that time, and you can play it again now for the first time
mm-hmm.
on Xbox One.
Yes.
The last game that came out this week, Daggerhood. Now available for Xbox One. Quite a few indie games, which also gets me thinking, we're getting close to GDC, the Game Developers Conference. It's a time where we tend to show off a lot of indie games. And so I think I'll have to report back on what I get to play. That's coming up in March, which yep. is, wow, just a couple of weeks away. So we should do one of these afterwards. I'll take some notes on some of the best indie games that I play. So we'll have some insight on what's coming out in 2019.
Busy, busy month. Big news this week.
Yeah.
Reggie.
Oh my God. We just found out before recording.
Reggie earlier this week.
Reggie Fils-Aimé.
Announced that he's retiring from Nintendo. I've known Reggie for a long time. I've seen him at events. He's a great guy. I've run into him at the health club.
Nintendo right across the street.
Yeah, it's about 1,000 feet from where we're sitting right now.
And I've been in an elevator with him once, and I think I've done a head nod. Like, I'm gonna acknowledge who you are, but you don't know who I am, and that's fine.
Right.
That's fine.
Yeah.
He doesn't listen to the show. Now we'll have time.
Right.
He's retiring.
But.
So congratulations to him.
And congratulations to Doug Bowser, who is his replacement. I know. You can't write this, Jeff.
So Bowser has now trended worldwide twice in the last couple of years. 4 years ago when he was hired.
Right.
And everyone's like, I can't believe Nintendo's hiring Bowser. Well, now they've put Bowser in charge.
Right.
And the headlines.
Your timeline is about to get
writing themselves.
This is a weird
But you
time
know Doug.
I know Doug. I've met him quite a few times. Same thing. He's unbelievable. He's a great guy.
That's
so
great.
This is phenomenal. So a lot of changes there. What else we got this week in news?
Really, from a news perspective, that's pretty much it.
I mean,
the big release is Anthem.
Yep.
And we're just coming off of like four other games and then a couple more coming out in the next few weeks. Like we had mentioned, the Division 2 and
yep.
Devil May Cry 5. And so it's just kind of banana cakes, as you might say.
Banana cakes is crazy. All right, well, we're gonna take a break here. I'm gonna run a roll this interview I have done with Kate Remington from Music Respawn from WSHU Shoe. Joining me on the line right now is the classical music program host for WSHU in Connecticut, my home state, is, ladies and gentlemen, Miss Kate Remington. Kate, thank you for joining me.
Oh, hey, Larry, it is just so much fun to be on the podcast. I'm a big fan, and it's great to have a chance to chat.
Well, I got to tell you, I heard you, you and I have been going back and forth on email for a few months. I heard an interview you did on NPR, National Public Radio, which is the national public radio here in the United States, and you are fascinating because you focus on video game music, which is why you're here.
Yeah, you know, it's such an underappreciated segment of game design. And that's kind of why I started the podcast, because I love listening to the music even away from playing the games. And it occurred to me that you hardly ever hear interviews or read interviews with game composers. And I was like, well, why is that? And why don't I just do that?
So you and I are kindred spirits, because I started my podcast in 2003. And one of the areas I always focused on was audio design. Of course, you know, music is part of that. But you are much more learned in this area than I am, because you actually went to school for music, correct?
Yeah, I was a piano major in college. And I got into music school because I really wanted to be a conductor. And then, like, my second semester, I realized this is really, really hard.
Oh, come on. I mean, I don't want to belittle being a conductor. Why is it so hard? Because I'm fat. Because I've always wanted to be one as well. Why is it so hard?
Well, it was hard for me because I didn't have the sort of the chutzpah, I guess, or the presence and authority to make these people play the music that I wanted it, the way I wanted it to be played. And so I went to a panel discussion about other things you could do with your music degree besides teach or perform. And one of the people who was there worked for Wisconsin Public Radio, and he made being on the air with a music show sound like so much fun. I was like, I'm doing that.
Yeah.
So I did, and that's how I got into radio.
Now tell me, because you talked about it off the air, I've been in radio as well, but tell me about the path that, you know, obviously radio have something for each of us, but how did it lead you into video games? You have a musical background, but tell me about the path that led you here.
Well, it was kind of a, I don't know, not a direct path at all, but I played Pong when it was new and then skipped a whole bunch of years. But when we got a Bandai iMac in like the late 1990s, it came bundled with this game called Nanosaur. And
sure.
It just totally sucked me in. And then I started playing Myst and Riven and discovering other games, and it just kind of snowballed. And mm-hmm. I'd play with my son, who's super, super into games. He's a level designer now. And so we'd go through, you know, console after console and all these different games. And the music was always something that we talked about. And it was just so cool to finally get the chance to really just, you know, pull up the wheels and go with the support of WSHU.
Yeah, which is great, because you work at a radio station. They're like, yeah, go ahead and do this. I mean, which is amazing. First of all, you talked about your podcast. How do people find your podcast to listen to you and your guests?
Oh, there's lots of ways. It's called Music Respawn, and it's in Apple Podcasts. It's on Spotify now. It's on the WSHU public radio site. I have my own site, respawnshow.com. So there's lots and lots of ways to listen. Oh, it's on SoundCloud, too. So there's lots of ways to track it down.
And I'll make sure I put a link in my show notes to make sure they can find you. Now, Kay, one of the reasons I wanted to have you on is because you and I are kindred spirits in the audio field and whatnot. Now, you are, like I say, you're much more educated in the music space, because I famously can't play music, but I have such an appreciation for it. When I went to Syracuse University, I took a lot of classes in classical music because I just enjoyed it so much, but I have zero musical aptitude. And one of the things I noticed when I started working in the video game industry many, many years ago is that classical music is a staple of video game music. Would you agree with that?
Oh, absolutely. And so many of the composers that I talk with will reference the composers that have inspired them to get the right sound for a game, like Will Roget, who's written music for the recent Call of Duty game and additional music for Destiny. He loves Debussy. And so anytime he can kind of use the sound of Debussy in his own music, you know, he loves that. And sometimes they get like really far afield. Like Jason Graves was listening to Penderecki's Threnody for the Victims of Hiroshima to get an idea for the sound for Dead Space. And so it comes from all over. But it's really fun to sort of have that Venn diagram of, you know, the intersection of game music and classical.
When you're looking at some of the classical music of previous games and games that are coming out, we talked, for instance, Anthem is out now and so forth, and there's a lot of games coming out. Apex Legends, I don't know if you had a chance to play Apex Legends, which I'm addicted to right now.
Not yet, but it's on my list.
But there's so much music that adds to the soul of a game. And I always challenge people who say, what do you mean? turn down the sound. Go into your settings and turn just, don't do it forever, but for a few minutes, turn down the audio. And usually you can separate, in the options, you can separate out the soundtrack. And you'll notice how, for lack of a better term, dry the environment is, right?
Oh, absolutely. In fact, I did this really cool presentation with Tom Salta, who also lives here in Connecticut, about that very thing. And he had a video of a game that he had scored. It was one of the Halo games. And at first he played it dry. But the cool thing is you can't just plop any old music in there. And so he played that same segment with two different music tracks, and it was a completely different feeling for each one of
right.
them.
So right.
that's the thing that really impresses me, because these composers just work so hard to get the music to be just absolutely a perfect fit for the games.
Yeah, and the other challenge they have is, when in my years of talking to composers and audio developers, is because we, and when I say we, I include you and all my listeners, we enjoy this non-linear format. It's even more challenging, and let me explain to some of the listeners, because I know, Kate, I think you know what I mean, is that when you sit and watch a movie or a TV show, you know it's going to be 2 minutes and 20 seconds. At an hour and 10 minutes, the protagonist is going to do this. There's this dramatic moment. With games, you don't know how fast or slow the player is going to proceed through a level, so you really don't know how to score it in a map to one-to-one to their actions. You can do the best you can, and technically, they know when you hit a trigger point that they're going to hit this cue, but it's very different, isn't it?
Oh, it's fascinating, and they all come up with different ways of dealing with that problem. You know, it didn't used to be a problem because, you know, the old days of like 8-bit music, the games were simpler and you just play one track, like for Mega
sure.
Man, just one track, because he basically was doing the same thing anyway, just, you know, running and jumping. But now a player could be doing anything. And like Bungie actually rebuilt their music engine so that it would be really adaptive to
right.
whatever the player would be doing. And then the challenge for the composers is to write music that can be broken down into these tiny little stems and like layered and then built up during a boss battle and then finish in a way that's like super satisfying. So, you know, yeah, I nailed that guy and I
yeah.
feel really good about it.
Yeah. You have this visceral, you know, in addition to the audio design of the environment, you know, you've got to, again, you have to layer in this music. Now, when you look back in the history of video game music, what are some of your favorite pieces and why?
Oh, man. Well, I'd have to say Tempest actually was one of my favorites. And it's,
yes,
we all have these, you know, really powerful memories of experiencing a game. And for me, I sucked at it. I was really bad at it. But my brother was really, really good. So I'd watch him play to try to pick up a few tricks. And I, you know, by default, listen to a lot of the music.
And that, for those of those folks that don't know, this was an 80s, early 90s cabinet game from Atari that had vector graphics and it had a dial and it was high resolution for its day. And it was intense, and you're right, the music was really something, wasn't it?
Oh, it was incredible. In fact, I was just listening to the soundtrack again. Somebody's put it up on YouTube, and it was like, yeah, these memories just like come flooding back, which is just so cool. And I guess, you know, I missed a lot of the early consoles, the Segas, and even NES. I missed out on NES because I was just doing other things. But there are some incredible soundtracks from like the late 80s, early 90s, mid 90s. You know, what Trent Reznor did with Quake is just like, oh
right.
my God.
Yeah.
That's incredible. It still just gives me like almost a panic attack because it's just like so intense.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, there's to your point, there's so much. It's such a rich history, and we've got a lot of people who have gotten into it in the past, like you talked about Trent Reznor and Quake. Who are some of your favorite art contemporary artists nowadays?
Oh man, I like a lot of indie bands, honestly. So like really quirky offbeat stuff. There's a Scottish band called the Fratellis that are really really cool. And so I guess, you know, that kind of indie sound is really interesting for me. The Shins are kind of cool. But, you know, I'm open to anything. I listen to lots and lots of stuff.
What are you playing right now, by the way? Let me ask that.
Let's see. Oh, well, most recently I booted up the Formula One 2015 season because it was on Game Pass, and it's just as hard as I remembered.
That's right, it is.
Got behind the wheel of Kimi Räikkönen's Ferrari and like crashed it right away. And so,
right.
I've also been playing Forza Horizon 4, and again, I did things to that McLaren Senna that no one should do. and, you know, Destiny keeps pulling me back in because it's just such a cool experience. And it's just, you know, it's the kind of game you can spend 5 hours playing, or you can play like for 20 minutes and do a quick little mission. And either way, it's like super satisfying.
Yeah. I mean, you talked about Forza Horizon 4. I mean, the music, now that's different because instead of the score being customized for the game, you know, that team went out and sought soundtracks, which are about the lifestyle of racing, right?
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. And that adds a lot too. I mean, and again, it's just a great example of how the team that makes these games really have to think about what's going to give the player the best experience. And in that case, it wouldn't be a classical inspired track because, you know, as much as you might love Beethoven, it's not really going to get your heart pumping the way the music that they put in the game does.
Yeah. I mean, you're absolutely right. When, you know, what would you give some advice to some folks who are budding musicians, who are video game fanatics, who really want to get involved with it? Can you give them some guidance?
Oh, yeah, sure. Because I ask this question of a lot of, especially the young composers that I'm talking with who are just getting started. And one of the things a few of them have done, which I think is really cool, is to take a trailer that they really love and wipe out the music and write their own music to the trailer.
Because
right. Then they've got like a really polished 2 or 3 minute thing that they can show somebody. The other cool piece of advice that I got, or a thing that his name is Callum Bowen, he did the music for Piku Niku. He kept an iTunes playlist, a bunch of playlists with pieces, songs and classical pieces with different moods. And so when he was stuck or he needed to write a piece to go to match a game's feeling, he would listen to that playlist. And then that would give him ideas for the kind of directions that he could take his music. So I thought those were two like really interesting ideas.
Now, I want to talk to you about some of what you've done in terms of working with at WSHU. You also, if I remember correctly, you teach as well, correct?
No, I'm just on the air. I'm the music. Yeah, I know. I'm just on the. I've got a classical show that is on from 9 to 1, and then I oversee all the classical music programming.
Now that's a lot of responsibility. Are you surprised? And I don't know because this is my perception. It feels like there's almost a resurgence of classical music, or did that just never go away? And I'm just more aware of it because it's now more mainstream with video games.
I think video games have a huge part to play in that because people are much more conditioned to just hearing orchestral music or even chamber music from playing games. So yeah, we have found too that the ratings for our classical music shows are going up, which is great because, you know, 15 or 20 years ago, people were like writing off classical music as a thing that only old people listen to. And that's right. just not the case.
But I also want to point out, as we talked about Forza Horizon, it's not just classical music that we see in the video games. It's some pop music. And I also want to point out there's this other side of it. You know, there's the pop music, the current stuff. But one of the games I will never forget is it was 2000, I believe it was 2006, and I was at an event, and we were showing, I was working at Xbox, obviously, and we were showing a trailer. It was at a rehearsal, so no one had seen the trailer yet. I hadn't even seen it yet. And I stopped dead in my tracks because the visuals grabbed me, but the music grabbed me, and that game was the original BioShock.
Oh, yeah.
Because Ken Levine and his team put so much thought into capturing that Art Deco 40s era that I fell in love with it. And I'm sure you've played that and you've seen the soundtrack.
Oh, my God. That was like one of those like epiphanal moments. I was watching it with my son and our jaws were like on the floor.
Right.
Because it was just so incredible. And the way that they, you know, incorporated that music, those sounds from the 40s and 50s. And that's another really cool thing. You know, video games have this thing that doesn't get talked about a lot called tangential learning,
yeah,
where you get so wrapped up in a game and then you want to like know more about it. And I know from my own experience and like, it was really cool. I totally forgot about Django Reinhardt. And all of a sudden I was like, listening.
How could you forget about Django?
he was just off my radar for a while. And so All of a sudden I was like listening to as much Django Reinhardt as I could find. And so that's such a cool thing that games give us that I think people don't really appreciate as much or really talk about as much.
Well, it's interesting you say that because I've told this story privately, and I think I may have told it on the air once or twice. Is my sister is a high school librarian in Rhode Island next to Connecticut.
Yeah.
And she'll always talk to me about what games are coming out. And I'll say, well, this, and this, and this will be hot, or, you know, this, so on and so forth. And she'll do, like, for instance, one of the great ones she did a few months ago was she did a presentation around Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
Mm.
Because she did something in her library, a little display about it, because she knew the kids were going to start coming through and asking about Egyptian history.
Yeah.
And sure enough, they started coming in and asked about Egyptian history and to a certain point, the music a little bit. That's another one that I think you've chatted about in the past is the wonderful ancient Grecian music in Assassin's Creed Odyssey.
Oh, yeah. Those guys from the flight had such a great time because they had kind of a shopping list that they took with them to Greece, and they wanted to get really authentic instruments. And it turns out, you know, in music history, we're always taught, there's no way to hear what ancient Greek music would have sounded like. But in fact, That's not true. Because if you go to Greece, the instruments that they played are still around, or at least really close a proximity to what those instruments would have sounded like. And so they had all these great instruments that they could use to give just a really authentic quality to that soundtrack. And so, yeah, that was a fun conversation.
Yeah, music, I mean, it's that music alone. And that's something that you notice that you know, unfortunately, a lot of composers don't get the credit because it's not the screen, you know, the shiny screenshot that you see online and whatnot. But sometimes they just don't get that credit because it's audio and it's tough to, you have to listen and focus sometimes to listen to it specifically because otherwise it's what I call sometimes it's audio wallpaper.
Yeah,
it's in the area you're playing, but you really don't pay attention to it because even though it's subtly, very subtly, and sometimes very pointedly enhancing the experience.
Oh yeah, and that's what makes it so cool is that it's not necessarily this sort of endless loop of music. It's really subtle. And like I remember talking with Jason Graves about Far Cry Primal, which is just an amazing score because he made it with like rocks and dirt
and it sounds it and it fits perfectly with Primal, doesn't it?
Yeah, it absolutely does. And it's so cool because as you're wandering around in the world, you can hear these sounds and you're not really sure if it's the music or not. But you know, things escalate because you've got to take down the woolly mammoth or whatever. And then it suddenly, you know, his soundtrack kind of like bursts right out. So it's subtle in ways until it's not. And then it like really helps you, you know, get the right feeling.
Yeah. The other thing I remember, you know, the funny thing about, I was having conversations with folks about music is a lot of people think game music and apologies, they think Rock Band or Guitar Hero, which again are great games, but they're not quite the same thing, right?
Right. Yeah. Or Dance Dance Revolution even. I mean, they're super fun. But
yeah, exactly. I mean, like Dance Central, you're certainly not going to become a great dancer. I can vouch for that. And you're not going to be a great band member in Rock Band. In fact, I remember I was doing an event with Guitar Hero, and a very famous guitar player was so upset with this game. And this guy is world famous because he felt that it minimized his talent.
Oh.
Which was interesting. I hadn't thought about that because I don't have any talent when it comes to music. But I was like, yeah, he said it trivialized his talent in that people think it's easy to play a guitar when you're just, because they're holding a plastic guitar in their living room, standing there in their boxer shorts. And it's not the same as being a true musician.
Yeah, well, that's a totally valid idea. And it is true. I mean, but I wouldn't attempt to hop in an F1 car either after driving.
That's the beauty of video games. Yeah. It takes you places you could never go.
Yeah, exactly.
So, Anyway, well, listen, Kate, I got to wrap it up here. I really want to thank you for taking your time to chat with me. I know that people can find you on WSHU, which is a Connecticut radio station, but I'm sure you stream online, correct?
Yeah, we do. It's WSHU.org. And again, the podcast is everywhere. So
yeah, and I'll make sure I put a link to that. I would love to have you on the show again in the future if you would be so kind.
Oh, I'd love to come back, Larry. This was really, really fun. Thank you so much.
All right. Thank you so much, Kate. Learning a ton about music. You really know a lot of the gaming music people over at Rockstar.
Right.
Kate here.
Yeah. I know Marty. I've always gravitated towards the audio guys because of my background in radio. And radio and audio and music it's all kind of in the same vein. And I've always tried to, and I even mentioned this during that, you probably heard me talk about that in the middle of the interview. So I've always had this kind of admiration for the audio guys, but also understood their challenges because you can't show great audio in a screenshot on a website, right? You just can't.
No.
You have to experience it by playing the game.
Huh. You know, you have a face for radio.
Now, we have a little bit of a programming note here.
Programming note? You mean an apology to me, Larry?
Jeff, I apologize to you. During the interview, Jeff took a moment and he went and looked up this Al Michaels Oswald the Rabbit thing. And I completely forgot about it.
You thought I was making it up.
I thought it was some kind of banana stunt. And it wasn't. It's a real thing. So why don't you go ahead and explain what this is? Oswald the Rabbit, we need to link to his Wikipedia. Of course, most people know who Al Michaels is in the U.S. He's an announcer. Jeff,
all right, so
take it here.
Yeah, anyway, the story, and I'm reading from ESPN here. There's a whole book practically written about this, but ESPN first acquired the rights to Monday Night Football in 2005. Before that, Monday Night Football was always on ABC. It was the longest primetime series.
Right.
And I think this is before ESPN and ABC were completely together. I don't remember.
Or bought by Disney.
Yeah, exactly. The problem was, they had two different production teams and only one game to do a week. So there was they had sort of a glut of cast on the ABC ESPN sort of.
An embarrassment of riches.
An embarrassment of riches. Okay. So anyway, Disney CEO Bob Iger ended up calling up NBC and said, look, we would be willing to let Al Michaels go if you can get us the rights to Oswald the Lucky Rabbit.
Which is one of the very first IPs, intellectual properties, that Disney created back, Walt Disney himself.
The beginning of Disney's career. Now how on earth NBC
it ended up elsewhere,
rights,
we don't know.
Who knows? And the point is, I think when that call was made, they had no idea who or what Oswald the Lucky Rabbit was. But it turned out, yeah, he was the precursor to Mickey Mouse. Actually, he was designed personally by Walt Disney back in the 20s.
Right, with Ubi Works.
And Bob Iger knew it was important to the Disney family. And within a week, him and Dick Ebersol, who's a legendary
sports guy.
Yeah.
Dick Ebersol.
They had done everything they needed to do with NBC Universal, received approval. And Al Michaels was traded for a fictional.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to
character.
Laugh, but it's
80 years after he was designed.
Yeah, it's.
I'll link out to that. I just thought that
where's
was
Where's
like,
Al
the
now?
Strangest
What's he
thing.
Doing now?
And then they, he's still doing Sunday Night Football with Joe Theismann, right?
Yeah, right.
Yeah. So, not Joe Theismann. Well, anyway, another quarterback.
You don't like football, do you?
I like the Eagles. Look, it's February.
Right.
I don't
right.
have to think about football for six more months.
That's right.
It's all soccer and baseball and basketball.
You got,
oh,
all, you got all that.
Did you watch the All-Star basketball this weekend?
Yeah, wow.
I know you're a big fan.
Wow. Yes, I did. I did. I was actually thinking about that. What happened to that poor guy earlier
in
the week
with
his shoe.
Yes, Zion.
He's just doing his job and his shoe unravels. That's terrible. That screenshot just makes me hurt.
Well, I think he's going to be okay.
Yeah, well, still, but it's one of those things you don't expect. You're trying to do your job.
Well, 36 seconds into his first game.
Right, that's what I'm saying. Right at the top.
Anyways.
Oh boy. All
that
right.
Happened.
Did you see the Samsung phone?
The foldable? The
yeah,
Samsung
what'd you think
fold?
Of that?
I think it looks awesome.
Yeah.
Like it's
expensive.
Yes. But there's a lot of, and I'm just, everything I'm saying, I read on The Verge, but there's a number of different companies that are, we've seen LG, they have a flexible OLED we saw during CES, like a roll-up TV that looked really cool.
Yeah.
So there are either have been announced or strongly hinted that this is going to be a new thing.
That's
is foldable phones. But when I looked at it, and then we were watching the video or sort of a cut down of the, and I can link out to it, to the Samsung briefing that they had this week. You can very quickly see where, oh, I could totally have use for this.
Right.
And, to be able to unfold your phone into a 7-inch laptop and play games, look at maps, watch videos, watch Netflix. You know, like when you're on a plane, obviously you can't really one hand it at that point. Mm-hmm. I first of all, I think the tech is really cool, and I like really cool tech.
Yep.
But this is the type of thing that makes me think maybe I should give Android a go. I've never had an Android phone.
Well, I'm fascinated by the tech as well. You know, I just want to be able to have something I can roll out and play my games or
very
whatever.
Literally.
So, you know, it's cool stuff.
Well, I will link out to the story from The Verge, mostly because they did a really good job of looking at the cutting down the video and. You know, giving you the salient points, and also because I'm sure Tom Warren listens to the show.
Does he?
He knows you're always dropping spoilers and megatons and the like.
That's what we do.
It is what you like to do.
I'm going
to
suck you.
No, I've long been drawn into your orbit, Larry. Whatever happens to you,
I know.
I've hitched my dreams to your star.
Oh boy, I'll be careful there.
Yeah, no, it's too late now. I've mouths to feed, Larry.
Anyway, we've got a lot coming up. We're I don't know how many days away from E3, 120?
That's 4 months, a little less than 4 months.
Yeah, a little less than 4 months, a lot going
we
on.
We haven't right. really talked much about it.
No.
You're not going to change that today.
No,
that's I'm not, telling you, I'm
just
not
merely pointing
you.
Out that it's coming up. We've got a bunch of episodes of this week, or excuse me, Inside Xbox coming up. We'll talk more of those about those when we can.
When we can.
I'll be taking some time off in April.
Really?
Yeah, I'm taking some time off in April.
So a little after PAX. You're just going to maybe stick around in Boston?
No. We're gonna head out to one of the islands in Hawaii. So
we
did last year. So we're gonna go
our 50th and most beautiful state.
It is. It is really. You grew up in Florida.
All right. Like this is.
I've never heard of a Hawaiian man. It's a Hawaiian man accidentally. You know, almost Armageddon.
Yeah, that happens a little bit less often. There.
It's a beautiful place.
You
so.
Have to bring me back some spam musubi.
Well, you can just buy it down that street from you with that.
Actually,
store.
There is a place that has it. Actually, what I do need you to do is get me some of those Hawaiian cookie company Kona cookies.
Yeah,
they're good.
Yeah, by the way, for those of you who listen internationally, I want to thank
I'm sorry. First of all, apologizing.
Well, I'm just going to tell you, I have to apologize as well for Jeff, but if you listen internationally, specifically in the mid-region of Germany, I am in need of help.
What's this?
I'm out of gummy bears. Our annual gummy bear trip from the Baron Company, these are not Haribo. This is a completely different company.
No.
That only sells locally, and they only have German on their website. And there you go.
Well, we're only in Germany typically once a year in the Rhineland and Cologne region. We have a great time out there, and invariably we end up spending somewhere in the neighborhood of €50 on gummy bears at Baron Company. But you have to sort of like. Plan ahead for what's my
extra
gummy
luggage.
Bear consumption going to be?
Yeah, right. For a whole year.
For a whole year. And, you know, you have an addition to your
it.
Family.
I
you
misread
have a,
it.
You have a child now, and so maybe that messed up your calculations. She's just probably throwing down those gummy bears every time you turn your head.
Anyway, I need to get more of those, but that's not a problem anybody here can solve. And if you can, then let me know, major@xbox.com.
Folks, you don't have to do that. Actually, I have some sour mangoes. If you want some, I'll bring them into work. I'll bring them into work for you.
No,
it's the least I could do.
Just a few.
Literally the least I could do.
Anyway, all right. Well, we're kind of coming towards the end of the show here because we've run out of time, things to say, and.
We don't want to waste your time.
We don't want to.
No.
We want to thank everybody for swinging by. If you want to learn more about that news, head over to news.xbox.com or my blog, majornelson.com.
That's a good one.
You can follow me at Major Nelson. You can follow Jeff
at Jeff Rubenstein.
You can't miss it.
It's the complaint dust.
You're one of the six people that I follow, I think, on Twitter now. Yeah.
Five. I was gonna say I feel like you unfollowed somebody recently.
I keep it lean.
Really lean.
I keep it very lean.
Well, you're not one of these people that follows like 100,000 people.
No.
Occasionally you get a follow from someone, you're like, ooh, so and so, and then it's like, oh.
I got this weird follow from, who is it from? I was looking at this and going, that's really weird.
You unfollowed E.
I did. He doesn't work here anymore.
Well, neither does Laura or Lith, and you're still following
him. Yeah, that's true. You know, I got to figure that one out. He hasn't said anything yet.
Oh, he knows.
Oh, does he?
He has to know.
I gotta text. I got to go have lunch with
him. I'm going to text him.
Thank you. Then I'll unfollow you.
Never mind.
Anyway, all right, we're gonna wrap things up, guys and girls. Thanks for listening. Thanks for downloading the show. What are you?
You updated your.
You haven't seen it.
No, I don't necessarily need to click through to the account. But I know you're a big fan of the Mozambique in Apex, and now that's forever enshrined. Jeffrey the worst is, gun in any battle royale.
Jeffrey has pointed out that in my Twitter bio, I say, and in addition to all the other stuff, it's Mozambique here. I always do that all the time in the.
You tag, yeah, that's.
I think
epic
I was doing
trolling
it when we were
is tagging the Mozambique.
It's quite Mozambique here. Anyway,
just give me my devotion.
We are the Mozambique of podcasts here, so thank you. For
at
that.
Best,
at best, to say the least, with no hop up.
Yeah.
So we'll talk to you next time. Bye bye, everybody. Thank you.